Very good morning to all my dear students. Today we will complete the chapter from trade to territory. In the previous class we have studied that after the death of Maharaja Ranjit Singh in 1839 and two prolonged war with the Sikh kingdoms, Punjab was finally annexed by Britishers in 1849. And we also know that they were using various kind of policies to have the annexation of India. So the next was the doctrine of lapse. Under the reign of Lord Dalhousie, the Britishers adopted the policy that came to be known as doctrine of lapse. The doctrine declared that if any Indian ruler died without a male heir, his kingdom would lapse. It means it will become a part of a company territory. According to this policy, the ruler who does not have any legal heir could not pass on their property to the adopted son, and it would be taken over by the Britishers. Satara, Sambalpur and Jhansi were annexed by this policy only, and we are very, very well known about Jhansi, Rani Lakshmibai. And finally, in 1856, the company also took over Awadh, and this time the British had added argument that they said that they were obliged on duty to take over Awadh in order to free the people from misgovernment of the Nawabs. These kind of incidents led to the revolt of 1857. We will study in other chapters. Now there was a need as the company has gained control over almost most of the India and had become master of Indian land, so now there arises a need of administering of the acquired territories. So Warren Hastings, Governor General from 1773 to 1785, was one of the many important figures who played a significant role in the expansion of company power. Hastings divided the British territory into administrative units called presidencies, and there were three presidencies: Bengal, Madras and Bombay. Each was ruled by a governor, and supreme head of the administration was the Governor General, that is Warren Hastings. He introduced several administrative reforms, notably in the sphere of justice. He established courts such as criminal court and civil court, and also appointed collectors to collect revenue and maintain law and order. The criminal court was still under Qazi and Mufti, but under the supervision of the collector. He also codified laws with the help of Hindu pandits and Muslim muftis in order to do justice as per the prevailing laws in India. And B. Helhelt translated Hindu law and Muslim laws into English for the benefit of European judges. And under the Regulating Act of 1773, a new Supreme Court was established and a Court of Appeal. The Southern Nizamat Adalat was also established at Kolkata. The Britishers were done with both annexation and administration now. So now they felt the need of the army. So here was a company army. The colonial rule in India brought in some new ideas of administration and reforms, but its power rested on its military strength. First, if we talk about traditional army, the Mughal army was mainly composed of cavalry, means sawars, trained soldiers on horseback. The cavalry dominated the army. And second was infantry, that is pedal soldiers, or you can say soldiers on foot. They were given training in archery, tirandazi and the use of sword. The Mughals did not feel the need to have a large professionally trained infantry, and the rural areas had a large number of armed peasants, so the local zamindars often supplied the Mughals with pedal soldiers. Now there was a need of having professional soldiers. A change occurred in 18th century when Mughal successors like Awadh and Banaras started recruiting peasants into their armies and training them as professional soldiers. The East India Company adopted the same method when it became recruitment for its own army. which came to be known as Sepoy Army. Sepoy Army's word has been taken from Indian word Sepai, it means soldier. As warfare technology changed from 1820s, the cavalry requirement of the company's army declined. Cavalry means the army on horseback. The company's army had to keep pace with changing military requirement, and its infantry regiment now become more important for them. In the early 19th century, the British began to develop a uniform military culture, and soldiers were increasingly subjected to European style training, drill, and discipline that regulated their life for far more than before. Now the conclusion is that East India Company, that started as a trading company, and to further its trading interest, the company started to interfere in the local politics and later on took control of local administration. Through various social, political and administrative changes, by 1857, the company took full control over 63% of Indian territory and 78% of the population. Remaining part remained under the East India Company under its indirect control. The East India Company had virtually now the whole India under its control. Now this is it about the whole chapter. Let's have a quick review of the whole chapter through this summary. Story begins in 1600 when the East India Company acquired a charter from the ruler of England, and it's granted the sole right to trade with the East. First English factory was set up near Bank of River Hooghly in 1651. The East India Company also persuaded Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb to issue a farman granting the company the right to trade duty free. After the death of Aurangzeb in 1707, many Mughal governors, subedars and big zamindars began asserting their authority and establishing regional kingdoms. Murshid Quli Khan, followed by Ali Wardi Khan and then Siraj Udaula, were the Nawab of Bengal. The conflict between Siraj Udaula and the Britishers led to the famous Battle of Plassey, and this Battle of Plassey took place on 23rd June 1757, in which the Britishers won the battle. And as per the deal with Mir Jafar became the Nawab of Bengal after the defeat and death of Siraj Udaula, right? And when Mir Jafar protested, the company disposed him and installed Mir Qasim in his place. After the Battle of Plassey, the actual Nawab of Bengal were forced to give land and vast sum of money as personal gift to the company officials. In 1764, the Battle of Buxar was fought between Britishers and Mir Qasim, when Mir Qasim denied the privileges given to Britishers. And finally, in 1765, the Mughal Emperor appointed the company as the Diwan of the provinces of Bengal, and they also got Diwani right of Bihar and Orissa. Robert Clive committed suicide in 1774 when he was caught in corruption. After the Battle of Buxar, the company appointed residents in Indian state. The company forced the states into the subsidiary alliance, and the king had to put an army of British. In 1799, the Britishers won the Battle of Seringapatnam against Mysore against Tipu Sultan. And the third Anglo-Maratha War was a final and decisive conflict between the British East India Company and the Maratha Empire in India. Lord Hastings, the Governor General from 1813 to 1823, issued a new policy of paramountancy. Company took over Sindh in 1843. And after the death of Maharaja Ranjit Singh in 1839, two prolonged wars were fought with the Sikh Kingdom. Ultimately, in 1849, Punjab was annexed by the Britishers. Under the reign of Lord Dalhousie, the policy of doctrine of lapse was adopted. Warren Hastings divided the British territory into administrative units called presidencies. He established courts such as criminal court and civil court, and also appointed collectors to collect revenue and maintain law and order. In the early 19th century, the British began to develop a uniform military culture, and the East India Company had virtually the whole of India under its control. In this way, this chapter has been completed. I hope you like it and you have understood everything clearly. Still any doubt, you can ask me. Thank you and have a nice day. God bless you all.